nowadays we have single core CPUs in the 70s, late 70s, 80s, and these are still widely used in many of the safety critical systems nowadays. And it's an inversion into multi-core in the about 1990s. And then we start to look into more complicated platforms with accelerators for like GPUs and also a lot of the interfaces between computing and also storage, such as memory, cache, and the network on chip. On the other side, the workload that we've been looking at is also emerging, right? Traditionally, we used to have very simple workloads, a simple piece of code being run again and again, and their behaviors are very deterministic. But nowadays, we start to see workloads that, for example, better captured by theoretic acid graphs because they have parallel structures, right? Machine learning models, and also there are more and more design requirements, maybe leveraging cloud and edge, and because of all these interconnectivities, you have more surfaces of being attacked. So you look into security perspectives, and also for embedded systems, one of the constraints that is often we look at is the resource, right? The energy efficiency, because they are either reserved or rely on energy harvesting. So all these trends lead to the study that we are interested in, which is this mixed criticality. So let me motivate you by visiting some of very, very simple examples that is well known in this domain, okay? The first example is just a one-line piece of code. You take the value from two registers, you sum them up and assign to a third register. Studies have shown that on a Motorola 8086, this simple line of code will always take 20 cycles to run. Okay, in the worst case, in the best case, always 20 cycles to run, very deterministic. But on this Motorola PC755, typically, or even most of the cases, it will take single-digit cycles to run. So it is more efficient. However, because of the complicated system architecture, okay, in the worst case, this line of code may take up to 321 cycles to finish. And this chip is today being widely used in a commercial aircraft. Most of the Airbus aircrafts use this chip on their machine. So on the other side, that means if we want to provide temporal guarantees for this line of code, we need to at least assign 321 cycles. And then if you look at this figure, this is a slide I borrow from a talk given by a technician from South, which does all the timing analysis for Airbus. And you will see that after they do all the timing analysis, like cache, input, output, and computation, and then adding everything that's this code, all the branch analysis, everything it can do, does the worst case analysis, what they will do is that if this single piece of code is very important, it will add a fudge factor of 90%, so we'll multiply it by 10 as the execution time estimation for a given piece of code. So what that means is that in addition to the 321 cycles, we will need to assign 3,000 something cycles to this piece of code in order to ensure it passes all the safety requirements given by FAA or all these regulations, right? So the gap between the average case performance and worst case guarantees that we want to provide is getting larger and larger, and the growth is exponential as the system becomes more complicated and more advanced. The reason is that commercial off-the-shelf processors and all these computational platforms, the design and all the efforts are being focused on providing better and better average case performances or typical case performances, and without looking at the worst case performances. So the worst case, the gap is getting larger and larger. So this leads to the design for as a necessity to visit mixed criticality design. And essentially what mixed criticality design is saying is that we want functionalities of different level of importance to share the same platform. Originally that was not allowed for safety critical systems. But now we have to do that for resource efficiency perspectives. That we should design the system in the following way such that it experiences multiple modes. Okay? Under normal circumstances, we expect those behaviors, for example, that simple line of code to finish within 10 cycles. And in this situation, we want all the tasks, everyone to meet the deadline. And in some rare circumstances, where these important tasks may need more execution, then they would receive that. And under the cost of you dropping some of the less important tasks. Okay, so this in general is the design of mixed criticality systems. And that is brought up by Steve Vessel from Honeywell Lab more than a decade ago. So in plain words, what this is saying is that you can consider this as, for example, in the weekend, I'm driving with my wife and we're going out for shopping. And there are a few places that my wife insists that we must visit. But then the traffic is uncertain, that there may be traffic jam and all this and that. But there is also a big list of other places that says I wanted to visit. But it's not that important. In some rare circumstances, if we experience a crash, a traffic jam, then I can drop my shopping list, okay? Stores on my list. But I have to ensure that the stores on my wife list has to be, we have to visit them, okay? So we want to provide some type of guarantees under different modes. And the guarantees can be different. So that's the general design for mixed criticality systems. For even just a simple uniprocessor systems, it's already proven that this problem is anti-hard in the strong sense, and which means that these are highly intractable problems that even like polynomial time approximation solutions is hard to find. And so this is kind of the why we look into strategies that are efficient but may not be optimal, because these are the hard problems. On the uniprocessor, it is in the very early stage, we know that there are good solutions. And we use the speed-up bound to capture how close these polynomial time approaches can be compared to the exponential time optimal solution. Okay, so you can view this as like a approximation ratio or like a resource augmentation bound for networking community. Okay, so basically I'm not optimal, but if my processor is faster than yours, then I can beat the optimal strategy. Then how fast does my processor need to be? This speed up bound captures that. So we want this speed up bound to be as close to one as possible, but these results show that for uniprocessor, the best possible speed up bound is 4/3, and this strategy that basically you follow a release deadline first, and for the more important jobs, because they may require more execution time, you kind of assign them a virtual deadline to follow, such that these virtual deadlines are earlier than their actual deadlines, and that gives them a little a promotion to their priority under normal circumstances. Okay? And then a lot of work has been ongoing since then. I'm trying to improve or get the best sphere bound for multiprocessor case. And our work in RTSS 2015, which is actually during my PhD study, proved that there exists an approach that can achieve the same speed up bound as the uniprocessor case. So we kind of close this problem for multiprocessors. Okay, so that's on the theoretical side. But then we kind of look back into this problem and say, okay, why is this problem so hard? And actually, we realized that it's because that this mode switch of the system, remember that we want to provide two type of guarantees, right? Under normal circumstances, no one should overrun their typical budget. And then in this situation, we need to guarantee everyone meeting their deadline, receive enough execution assignment, right? And then the system, if any task overruns, the system immediately triggers a mode switch. And right before this mode switch, we know nothing about who may overrun or anything. So we have no clairvoyance to the future. That is the key for making this problem so hard. What happens if we can kind of gain a little bit of information, right? If this piece of code already runs for 90% of its whatever lines, okay? If 100 lines, it already runs 90 lines. Then we kind of have some idea, even there is a mode switch, even it's going to experience some delay. Maybe that delay won't be so much, right? So all this goes back into how we model these uncertainties and the unknowns. So that's why here we looked into possibilities of why overrun may happen. For example, it could be because of the system slows down itself, right? We know these laptops, if you it overruns and overheats, it will lower its main CPU frequency so that it protects itself, right? We also know that there is this GALS design that you have clocks that are globally asynchronous, but locally each place you have a local clock, and you can delay those clocks when there is a signal delay. So basically, you wait for your signal, you delay your clock, and the signal still comes, so that logically everything is correct. That means your local clock is not at a constant speed, right? And that means that your frequency, right? Your frequency is also varied during run. What happens if these overruns are caused solely by the frequency job of your processor? Okay? So we model this differently and realize that we can actually, we're facing a problem that's not any hard at all. We can derive polynomial time optimal solutions and even improve it into just an n log n, where n is the number of jobs. So this is basically the time to sort all the tasks, prioritize all the tasks based on their deadlines. So it is possible to get very efficient solutions for almost a similar problem, that you still want to mix with quantity design. Now it's just when speed goes down, you kind of monitor the main frequency and you trigger the mode switch. And if that's the case, you can have polynomial time optimal solution for mixed-criticality scheduling. Okay, so that's one side of the story. So this makes us to look back into this mixed-criticality design and say, okay, so what happens? Because previously what we have is that under the normal mode, the speed is high, we want to guarantee everyone to work, right? And then the mode switch is triggered by a speed jump. Okay, processor is slower, so things will overrun, and we only guarantee important ones, right? So that's the previous setting. We know how to solve that problem. What if we flip the problem? Now it becomes a more a energy efficiency design of your real-time systems, where in normal mode, you want to stay as low as possible. You want to run everything as slow as possible. But then, if some important tasks overrun, what you will do is you will increase your processor speed to the normal mode, to the normal speed, right? So previously it's low speed, now it's higher speed, so that can accommodate your additional workload. So we look into this problem, and recently we find out there are several interesting findings. That first is we can change the fluid schedule into a deadline-based schedule without using any optimality. But then we are able to show that this can be extended to multiprocessor and even heterogeneous processor as well. But what we don't know is whether this problem is going to be hard or not, the new one. So that is still remains as an open problem. We aren't able to find any optimal solution yet, but we are able to get some results. And what we further looked at is when we have a heterogeneous platform, like a CPU, GPU setting, we realize that it may not, because so far what we are have been looking at is just the computation, right? You may need CPU part, you may have GPU part, right? Depending on how many cores we can assign you, that kind of, you have a very execution time. That's where we look into the GAN task. But then what we further looked at is in CPU, GPU setting, we realized that the PCIe bus that are connecting these computing units are kind of non-preemptive, and also it's like a one-way. So the communication delay or the time to transfer data from one computation unit to another may become the bottleneck, okay, from timing perspective. Especially nowadays, GPU is becoming so powerful, and we've seen a lot of work doing compression of the machine learning models. So the inference time may be so small that using GPU is fine, but to provide all the data it needs, and then to take the data back to the CPU, that may be the bottleneck. That's why we started looking into this, how we modeled it as a two-phase task, where you have a non-preemptive communication region, which is in green, and then following with a GAN type of GPU parallel execution unit. And if you're given a bunch of this type of jobs or tasks, how can you schedule those, pile it up, so that your next span or kind of your response time is minimized? So we also looked into this type of problems and find out some very interesting heuristics that can lead to nice theoretical bounds, and also experimentally works very well. So that's kind of the line of the work we did on the modeling and scheduling of real-time tasks. These are still kind of quite abstraction of simple units, where we don't look at the inner structure of the code. But then we realize that also the other line of work, we start to look into the structure of the code. Basically, what we call DAG, directed acyclic graph, or graph-based task. And this kind of represented by kind of like a directed acyclic graph, right? And it kind of reveals the interconnections or interdependencies, predecessor constraints between different units of a big computation task, and has many wide applications such as TensorFlow, NMP, ROS, and so on. So my group has been focusing, for this line of work, my group has been focusing on improving the energy efficiency of those platforms. So we have developed a general framework of how to handle this task when your objective is to find out a good schedule, a good execution pattern, and frequency setting for your platform, and even its heterogeneous or clustered platform. And the way is to first decompose the DAG task into the frames of different frames. So you look at the interdependency constraints and assign tasks, subtasks into the different frames. And then you try to adjust these frames so that so there's a certain balance between number of processors needed and which ones share the same platform. And then you can do some merging, right? Because many of the cases, even this processor remains idle here and here, it is costly to have an additional processor to be ready. So we want to get rid of such kind of inefficient usage of the processors to reduce the total number of processors. And so that's why we do an intra-task version. And then this is just one task, right? You have multiple tasks, you have multiple DAGs in your system. Then the next question becomes, which task should co-run with others? And that we Interestingly, we find that it's a very similar problem with a maximum independent set problem, which is the typical graph theory problem that can be solved. There are efficient solutions that can be used to solve it. And we also tested it on actual platforms like this Android 3, where precise estimations can be made on the energy consumption of the board itself. Okay, and on the theoretical side, we also does analysis for the response time. So given all these tasks and given a certain scheduler, for example, like we look at OpenMP and we look at graph, and we try to compute the exact worst case response time. So that means the time when you're released and get into the ready queue until the time you're finished based on certain deadline settings or scheduling algorithms. From end-to-end delay perspective, this is very important for a lot of the control systems that we look at. Okay, so this is the that part. And for the application, we look into loss tool. And this F110, which is a 1/10 scale autonomous racing car that leverages LED cameras and the LiDAR as the major sensors, and it does have a the Jetson TX2 and RNX as the major computing unit. Ah, yeah, here it is. Of course, you can use it for other purposes, but what we have been looking at is mainly for on ROS, which is the robotic operating system. Very recently, there is a major shift in robotic operating systems towards ROS 2, which uses a publisher-subscriber model for all the communications. So it is finally possible to provide real-time guarantees for if you are leveraging ROS 2. ROS 2 is viewed as a middleware that lies on top of your operating system and supports all these chains of workload that you have, right? And you can consider this timer event as a sensor that actually running at a certain frequency. Okay, so every time I take some input, it's pushing on, and maybe you're leveraging some GPUs and machine learning models to process this sensor data, right? And then this may be your control algorithm to how to process and find the actuation and push it out, right? So that's kind of the thing that you typically do for one cycle. But remember, you have multiple sensors, and the system will run in different modes, right? Your car may be going straight forward, your car may be in the highway, or maybe making some turns and maneuvers in a city, inside the city with a lot of pedestrians, all these bicycles, right? So different modes, under different modes, you may have different chains or functionalities and the levels of like requirements that you have. And so what we are trying to do is to improve the ROS2 scheduler by changing the executor of ROS2 to make it support deadline-based scheduling. So that's the first thing that we do. And we are the first ones look at deadline-driven scheduling under ROS2 to provide guarantees. This is the latest work that is published in DAG last year. And I do want to show the demo for this ROS2 system. Let me see if I can share that. This is our simulator. You can see this is the car, and the red lines, the actual the black lines are actually the boundary of the track. But what we are trying to do here is by using the red lines to make sure that no matter how the car rotates, right? As far as its center does not go beyond the red line, the car will not touch the boundary. That's the first thing that we set. And then this blue dotted lines kind of sets the restrictions. In addition to that, we do have a model-based controller that looks into a certain time frame ahead and calculates what is the optimal path for the next about 20 to 30, 40 steps. And you can see that we did model all this drifting and the physical limits, behaviors of the car, so that it can make the turns very smoothly based on the how the surface conditions and the car's physical limits. So you can see that the yellow is to the front, but the car may not be facing the front at all when making some of these turns. Okay, so that's one example. And then you can see, let's look at another example. So this example where you will see is that we do have mode switches. It will suddenly detect. It will suddenly detect an obstacle, and then in this situation, you will see that this is a smooth running. But then you will see that there will be an obstacle it will not be able to detect until it makes this turn, and suddenly it detects. That's where it sets the additional green dots to avoid that obstacle upon detection. So it is actually being ready for any obstacle to appear in any situation. That's why it's guaranteeing that in the worst case it may be able to go through, but then if it really happens, it immediately makes a mode switch and knows that where it should actually be lying with it. And so there is a mode switch at around this point where it starts to detect that obstacle. And then it acts more safely in upon that detection. So the key thing is if you don't see anything, you have to be prepared for anything that could appear so that you stay within the safe. But then you can do any optimization you want as far as you stay safe, right? And if really these things happen, then you just act according to that. So let's look at one last example. We have a similar situation. I think this is another obstacle. This is maybe just a enlarged one, so you can see that it doesn't see the obstacle, so all the green lines are still there, but then suddenly it sees it and it makes the rotation. Okay, so it knows that it can drift away, so even if it's facing backwards, it can still drift. So coming back to the slides, yes, and so that's the F110's application that we looked at. We are not really striking to win the race, but we still are able to achieve like a second position in the latest competition. So this is a software competition. Everyone uses the same hardware, same platform. And so it's about how you design the algorithm and race. And what's different from us with the other team is that we never hit others when doing head-to-head racing. So we are really stay very cautious at guaranteeing the safetyness of our car. Okay, and we further. One other application that we look at is robotic legs. So this is a very important issue because many people have kinematics or joint ankle problems. And currently, the current practice is you must have a lab with like 12 or 16 cameras set all over the ceiling to monitor the patient and to know its walking and behaviors, to kind of do the 3D guest estimation. But what we are trying to do is that we believe daily living situation, right, indoor and outdoor, these are the much more general environment that any patient would live in. And in these situations, we cannot rely on any type of cameras or any systems that is just impossible to set up in an outdoor surface. So what we can really leverage is just whatever sensors you can add onto your shoe, onto your device, and at most maybe like a cell phone or a small camera. So basically the problem becomes that given this very simple IMU sensor input, how can we recover the 3D motion, especially on the lower limbs? So basically the ankle angle, right, the knee angle, the hip angles. So these are the output that we wanted. So we've been looking at how to leverage, for example, knowledge distillation and deep neural networks to study the data from all these camera captured precise analysis. But also we are trying to make the model a little gray box that you can explain. That's why we are also building, leveraging the state of the art, like human muscle and bone system study to build, basically our muscles are like tensions, right? So we are building all these models and injecting it into the neural networks that we build so that we can have a good estimation based on the IMU sensors. And we are, so far we can reduce the number of IMU sensors to just the 3 of them. And we are able to achieve an accuracy for about less than 3 degrees of error on average. And this is when we are using training data on certain patients and testing on different patients. If you are using the same patient as testing, we can achieve much higher accuracy and result. Okay, so that means that this model can be transferred and applied to a new patient, as far as we know, some basic physical information about the patient. Okay, so this is another application that we looked at. So coming into more like ongoing work, okay, one of the directions and interesting things that we looked at is to inject certain randomization to the safety critical system. And this idea is kind of counterintuitive because typically we want safety critical systems to behave deterministically, right? We want to know what they must do, what they will do in a deterministic manner. But that is not the case. So I can give you a very simple example, which is quick sort. We all know that quick sort in the worst case runs in order of n squared time. But on average case, it runs in n of n time. And in practice, it runs very efficiently. It is a quick sorting approach. So this means that if you're given an array of elements, and if you're doing a randomized quick sort, the likelihood of that pivot you select being the largest or the smallest, that it does not partition it well, will be very low if you do a randomized line of the quick sort. Right? So this kind of gives, and actually theoretical computer scientists have been developing ways to measure how likely does that happen, right? And that is called concentration dots. Yes. So that's why we start to look into how concentration bounds can be used to help us prove that the systems will fail in what probabilities. And if that probability is small enough, for example, 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 9, then it's better to inject randomness into our scheduling decisions so that we can still satisfy the permitted failure probabilities that are often specified by industry standards. So we don't have to be 100% safe, right? That happens in, I think IEC, this is the, I think this is the, IEC is probably the railway system failure probability. There's FAA, like 178C for avionics, and there will be one for sure for autonomous driving systems as well. They don't require 100%. It's just a low probability, a low enough probability to fail. And as far as there is a certain probability, then injecting randomness wouldn't lead to completely failure of your design of the system. And the good thing about injected randomness is that you become safer to adversary attacks because you're making random decisions. So if there's a particular attack that knows what your decision will be deterministically, then that attacker can kill your system easily. But if your decision is random, you may take this one this time, next one that time. And if your attacker has to be right every time, then it's almost impossible for the attacker to really attack your system. So that's kind of the idea. And then once we have this randomness, then of course we can build distributions, right? Behaviors. For example, if we know some distribution of your execution time or worst case execution time, then we can start to look into the energy consumptions on the average case, in the worst case, and so on and so forth, and be much better in handling all these uncertainties and modelings, right? And furthermore, we look into attacks, right? Side channel attacks, and how can mitigate that with by handling cache, okay? By doing some cache flush or doing some time and space scheduling to partition, to provide some isolation or partitions to your tasks to provide some safety guarantees. Okay, so I think I will stop there. And these are my, a lot of the works are done actually by my students and with my collaborators. So certainly thank them and the sponsors. I'll take any questions that you may have.
Thank you. With a mixed criticality, broadly speaking, is there any, maybe you mentioned about the NP hard sort of issues, and it seems like if I have five tasks, it's intuitively easier than if I have 5 million tasks, and just even assigning which ones are the ultra critical ones and which ones are slightly less critical. Is it a tractable thing, Stephen, from the labor point of view, if I have a large number of tasks to be able to say, especially in terms of their interactions, that these are the really critical ones that always have to meet their targets, and these are slightly less critical?
I think the NP-hardness goes into how large your problem is, right? If it's just a single-digit number of tasks, it doesn't matter whether you're doing a brute force exhaustive search or not. But as systems becomes more and more complicated and shared, the expectation would be that, like for example, all the cars, even just the wires is like 30, 40 miles long on one car, if you count all the wires. So we're trying to integrate all these systems together instead of having a system for this, a system for that, and all these. So as systems get integrated, the functionalities and the number of pieces of code being run on a certain system becomes larger. And this also is true not just for cars, for IoT in general. That's because I think sensors are cheap, right? The computation units are cheap. So it's affordable, so affordable that to just add more sensors onto it. But all this leads to more and more complicated workflows. They may interact with each other. So I think that's the general trend. That's why we need to look into scalable solutions for these systems.
I'm also curious on a related line. You mentioned sort of chip design. One of the things that's done in EDA is statistical timing. So instead of saying, my chip has to make the worst case in this dimension, all the different dimensions. You just say, all the different dimensions is like 1 in 10 to the minus 80, and that's never going to happen. So we'll just take a statistical distribution. I wonder why, even in things like Airbus or cars or whatever, you can't take a statistical distribution where you say if it's less than 1 in a trillion, whatever, it contributes essentially to 0.
Oh, I absolutely agree with that. I think this type of modelings are necessary. Like, so previously, the worst case diffusion time estimation domain looks into static analysis, right? Offline static analysis. But I think there is a shift towards more statistical based, where we provide like certain probabilistic guarantees instead of a absolute 100% guarantee. This is true for in practice as well. So that's why we also started looking into this. And I think knowing some distribution, or it may not be a distribution, it may be just the 1-2 threshold with probabilistics associated, or maybe that probabilistic corresponds to a distribution, maybe it's just how we are confident with our estimation. Either case, we could accommodate that in our scheduler designs, and to cope with the requirements for the whole system certification perspective.
So I'd like to ask a question. I really enjoyed the talk, by the way. Thank you. My question has to do with lockstep. So as far as I understand it, in automotive and generally in safety critical systems, basically dual or triple core lockstepping is used to have multiple cores that perform the same code, you do majority voting, things like that. How do you envisage this sort of technique that you're looking to working with triple core lockstep and things like that?
Okay, that's a very good question. So in general, here we are talking about timelines, right? If something fails, you kind of run additional things, or maybe you need additional time to finish something. So that's the fault tolerance in terms of time. And what you are saying is fault tolerance in terms of logic. Like if you have a sensor failure, or if you have different results coming out, right? So you run different versions of things, and that's quite valid. But from timing perspective, if you want to certify your system, right? First you have one chain of this and other chains of that, and then you do that. But from timing perspective, these are independent tasks, and each of them we should provide sufficient time to make sure we meet their deadline. And think about this. If, let's say, you have three of these and you need a majority vote, it's better that all three of them finishes within a certain time frame so that when you vote, everyone casts in their votes, right? So from timing guarantee perspective, the problem doesn't change. It's basically this, you have three versions independently, and you have to provide timing guarantees of all three of them, or else everything collapses. Right? When you're voting, it becomes two of them, or even just one of them, then the whole design collapses. So timing guarantees doesn't change. It's, if you have multiple versions of it, you have to provide guarantees to all of them.
Okay, thank you.
And thank you for your kind note.
I had another question. You mentioned mixed criticality systems dating, I think, 2007 in Vestal. But my recollection is the Apollo 11, when it was landing, they were getting these program alerts, which was basically the computer on the lunar module could not keep up with all of the tasks that it had to do, and so it was shedding some of them. They may not have called it mixed criticality systems, but it seems like that design was a mixed criticality design. I'm just wondering if you're aware of that, or if that seems accurate.
That's an example I put in my real-time system course. I think I put it there in the first lecture. And also, like, 1997 Mars rover problem almost failed, and that's a resource sharing problem, where there's a middle level importance of task that's not using the resource, but it's blocking a low level task that's holding the resource. And the low-level task is holding an important resource, but it could not execute because there is a middle-level task running. And then the high-critical task comes in and say, I need that resource, so I have to wait. but then it keeps waiting for this new level task to finish. So here is an deadline miss, and that's considered critical, so the system just reboot itself every minute or so. And that's the Mars rover and Apollo 11. Exactly what happens there is that it's not automatically dropped, right? Mixed criticality design now is saying that we should define a mode switch so that the system automatically drops when it needs and recovers itself. But Apollo 11, I think, is manic. Like, we injected some something too remotely to decide, okay, tell it, okay, drop this, drop that, then run. Right, so it's more a manually, you don't want that to happen on your car, right? You have to have someone plug in something and tell the car to drop something so that it can react to this braking function that you just applied. We want all these to be automatic at the impact. But that is, I think, a good example of where mixed criticality essentially is needed for the actual system to kind of go over these circumstances that may be expected but not likely to happen.
Okay, well, thank you very much, and I echo the comment here that really excellent, interesting talk. So thank you very much.
Thank you again for having me.
And so our final speaker of the day will be Brendan Regan, but we have a break from roughly 2:30 to 3, so please come back in about half an hour and hear Brendan's talk on fully holomorphic encryption and all the sort of advances that are being made there to make it more practical and interesting and useful. Stay tuned. Really interesting set of topics here. So. Very great speakers.